This is CNN, a network of Turner Broadcasting System.
Just tell you some of the things Paul Harvey has won. He's won the Freedoms Foundation Award 11 times. He's had 11 honorary degrees. The National Association of Broadcasters Radio Award, we mentioned that before. He's going to be honored this Saturday night with a major dinner in his honor thrown by the famed Museum of Broadcasting in Chicago. His broadcasts and columns have been reprinted in the Congressional Record more than 100 times. He's one of the more popular after-dinner speakers in the United States. How'd you get into doing that, by the way? Speaking to groups.
Well, Angel tells me that applause is a narcotic, that I have to go out periodically to get my fix. That may be part of it. But also, Larry, those of us who really prayerfully consider what we're doing a responsibility do feel an obligation to get a little feedback. And that's the only way I can afford to do it. Get out of the ivory tower and get out there and let people talk to me.
How, though, do they book you? Are you hard to get?
Well,
on the speaker circuit, they tell me that.
I'm the most overpaid person in the world for everything that I do, because I'd do it for nothing if my wife would let me. But it's all done through my Chicago office. We don't have booking agents or anything.
You don't use an agency?
No, never. Never have.
How far ahead are you booked this week?
A couple of years.
Okay. And is it true, I've heard this, that when you book Paul Harvey, you don't have to worry about hotels or stuff like that. Paul Harvey gets there and goes back on his own. You pay whatever the rate is, and that's it.
I'm surprised that you're aware of all this, but yes, that is true.
Okay, so you have your own airplane, and you just go when you want to go and go back when you want to go.
It's the only way. Chicago's a convenient hub. You can speak in any corner of the country and be back in a couple of hours. It's about the only way I can get out and back between broadcasts.
All right. Why is it hard? Why don't we see you more on programs?
Television?
Yeah. Guests.
I haven't had a lot of time for that. I've wanted to pay my dues for the Broadcast Communication Museum, and for that reason have made myself available for those things recently. But also, we're contemplating a new cassette next month. This wasn't supposed to be announced for a few more days, Larry, but we're a new cassette, Rest of the Story cassette next month, and we're going to dramatize the rest of the story for television after the first of the year, and there's another book coming out the first of the year, so I've really so many irons in the fire that anything extracurricular is
The Rest of the Story is a television show.
Mm-hmm.
A half hour?
No, it'll be an hour in 3 20-minute segments, a trilogy.
Great idea, and we act out and have a surprise ending.
Mm-hmm.
You narrate it?
Yes.
Actors?
Oh, sure.
Major, this is a, like, prime time kind of thing?
Well, we hope so. We haven't discovered yet in what form it's going to be released, syndication or network.
Who writes the rest of the story?
My son. Mm-hmm. Young Paul is also my morning announcer. Hardly anybody knows that, but he's a very capable young man.
You mean he's the one that says, and now Paul Harvey News mm-hmm. from Chicago?
Mm-hmm.
All right. About him, and I don't...
We were on together with you a few years ago.
That's right, and we talked about this. And this mm-hmm. was in Chicago. When you changed on the Vietnam War, Paul Harvey went from hawk to dove. The accusation was, and this is not new to you.
Larry, I'm going to interrupt you here just for a minute, because that was the kind of an allegation that got Quayle in trouble recently, that he went from dove to hawk, that he skipped his military service in Vietnam, that he was opposed at that time to the Vietnam War, and later in the United States Senate became a militaristic hawk. That is not inconsistent, Larry. It's not. The war in Vietnam was a pulled-punches war with our best sons, but less than our best weapons. And we've now learned in Korea and in Vietnam and the Soviets in Afghanistan that these small wars are just too debilitating to tolerate. They cost more than they're worth.
Oh, I remember the broadcast day when you said, this war ain't worth it. It was one of the great broadcasts of all time. What I meant to ask, were you personally hurt when people said you did it because your son was going to go to war?
No. I'm used to those slings and arrows. That wasn't so bothersome. But let me just finish this now, Larry. We've been without a world war for 42 years for the first time in history in this country. Because big wars are too horrendous for anybody to contemplate. This, I think, was all Quayle was trying to say. As best I, and I, this Ooh, my goodness. I know him only because I played golf with his grandfather. I've never met him. But it seems to me that it's perfectly consistent to say I am opposed to the tactics and strategy we are employing in Vietnam, but I am in favor of a powerful military, powerful enough to enforce peace.
Did they die in vain, those 50,000 whose memorial?
Not if we've learned what not to do next time. Then the first war we ever lost may be the first one we ever won.
In World War II, were you covering that as a young man in Oklahoma?
Well, actually, I was director of news and information for the Office of War Information in Michigan and Indiana for the early part of that war. I enlisted in the Air Force. Subsequently, the Air Cadet program was abolished and everybody was put in infantry. And I bowed out at that point, and before I could get back in, we'd run out of war.
Well, there are a lot of young
people. I'm no hero, no war
hero.
We
don't remember, though, a popular war. By that I mean a war that everybody was involved. We all, children,
yes.
It didn't matter. You didn't have that extra tire for the car. If it went flat, you didn't have a car.
I grew up with a generation, Larry, that believed, it's my country. May she always be right, but right or wrong, my country. With this now generation, that's not good enough. They want their country to be right. And they're
right. What's wrong with that? Because Germany could have said that, my country right or wrong, so I'll march for Hitler.
Amen.
So we want it to be right.
Amen.
Do you like it better now?
Our country?
Yeah.
Tomorrow always has been better than today, Larry. I don't see how an historian can conceivably be pessimistic. Tomorrow always has been better than today. I was in Bermuda a little while ago. How much time? We have another minute.
Oh, okay. We got 15.
I was in Bermuda recently. Angel and I had wanted to go for a long time. She'd romanticized it with the carriage rides and all that sort of thing. And we got there to discover that Front Street in Hamilton is a traffic jam, much like any of our major cities in this country. Smaller cars, but nonetheless cars and mopeds. We did, however, for purposes of a little romantic ride, get one of the carriage drivers. They take you a circuitous route up in the suburban areas. And took a ride in one of the carriages just to say that we had been in a carriage ride in Bermuda. And I said to the driver, how long have you been at this? He says, oh, I've been at this for 40 years. I says, my, you must long for the good old days without all the bumper-to-bumper traffic. And he said, the good old days? He said, the good old days in this town, every street was ankle-deep in manure. The stench was stifling. The disease was pandemic. Cholera, fleas, and flies, and other airborne bacteria, it was virtually unlivable. And I've reflected on that so often since, how we romanticized the good old days. Anything before penicillin, anything before heart surgery, those weren't good days, Larry.
Depression, what a laugh, right? These are the good old days.
Amen. Yeah, you bet.
Right. Now, we're going to find out in a moment what keeps that trigger going in this extraordinary man. Our guest is Paul Harvey. He's our only guest tonight on Larry King Live. We'll be right back. Don't go away. Our guest is Paul Harvey, where we're getting the best of the story.
Another program idea.
What, do you rev yourself up? I mean, what, you're how old now?
Let's see, my birth certificate says one thing, my passport says another, and my wife and mother say something else, and I'm not going to argue with any of them. But the last thing I saw in a Chicago newspaper Friday, it said 70.
Were they about right?
They were about right.
Is it still as exciting? I mean, do you still get a kick going in?
Oh, sure.
I mean, it's never just another day?
Oh, my. I told these dear NAB people this morning that I will retire tomorrow If somebody can name for me something that's more challenging and more fun than what I'm doing now.
So you don't have to rev yourself up. It is, I mean, it's a natural thing to you.
Now, there are some dark brown mornings in Chicago, Larry.
Yeah, January 6th.
When we maybe have to practice a little of what Clement Stone and Norman Vincent Peale practice when they stand in front of a mirror and say, you're handsome, you're healthy, you're terrific. Yes, I guess sometimes we have to sort of pick ourselves up.
Why then did you not leave Chicago? I mean, Paul Harvey, like the gorilla, can live anywhere he wants. With modern ability to deliver information, which is what you need before you write your news, you could do that news in Los Angeles, you could do it in San Diego, you could do it in Arizona. Why do you stay in Chicago?
Well, it's interesting that you ask, because we're turning the key on a new home in Phoenix in another month, and probably we'll be spending some of the winter weeks down there.
You could broadcast out of that home.
Yes.
Do you broadcast out of your house now, too, or are you still...
No. In each instance, I'll still broadcast from the studio.
Well, why have you stayed?
I can't keep my perspective in New York City or in Washington, D.C.
Oh, but how about a sunny climate? How about Phoenix?
Intellectually, I'm afraid I'd be enough out of the mainstream there so that I might go to sleep, so that I might not really care too much anymore. We're going to try this very carefully, starting the first of the year, and see if that's true.
In other words, you're going to broadcast that.
I hope I don't discover I've been making a mistake all these years. No, the broadcasts would be better from there.
You want the Chicago Tribune every morning.
The stimulation of the loop is useful, yes.
Now, New York, I jumped in there. You couldn't work in New York, why? Which some would think is more stimulating.
I'm very impressionable. And after just a few weeks in New York, I come to think that the sun rises behind the UN building and it sets in the Appalachians, and that's all there is to this country. That anything really important is going to happen here. Now, I'm serious. I get this feeling. I want to be out there where the votes come from. I want to see our country through a wide-angle perspective. I have subscribed in my own office, for example, to a California, special, separate California news service, because I've thought California is being ignored by the Manhattan-based media. I've gone to great lengths to be sure that the broadcasts have breadth and depth as well as height. It's been very expensive for ABC to keep me out there. They maintain studios and offices just for that purpose. But I believe they have just about decided now it's worth it.
I guess. How about Washington? Why couldn't you live here?
I'd get preoccupied with the machinations of the two ends of considerations concerning obscure things that Aunt Betty in Kalamazoo doesn't really care about. Now, I, again, I'm too impressionable. Some of our newspaper may be able to work here and keep their perspective. I couldn't.
So you buy the inside the beltway mentality that people in Washington just keep meeting with each other and deciding what they think is important.
That would influence me.
So you avoid it.
Oh, yes.
Our guest is Paul Harvey. We're going to take a break. We have about 8 minutes left with one of the reigning heroes of the broadcast industry. There isn't any person in this business desiring to make it in this business who doesn't hold Paul Harvey in high regard and with due respect. He's a living legend. If I have to tell you who he is, you have a major problem. We'll be right back with Paul Harvey. He's going to be honored this Saturday night by the Hall of Fame, the Broadcast Radio Journalism Hall of Fame in Chicago. We'll be right back after this. Our only guest tonight is Paul Harvey. We'll discuss some of the changes that you've seen in a lifetime. Like CNN, things like this, C-SPAN, cable. We're information junkies, aren't we?
Oh, perhaps. I've just watched the evolution of the communications media, however, through so many generations of it, and each was so terribly fearful of what was coming. Newspapers were scared to death of radio. Radio was scared to death of television. And television got scared to death of FM and
cable's coming
one thing after another. Now cable is crowding them, but each is better for the other.
They all hold the pie, don't they?
You bet. However, I think your CNN, unmistakably on the ascendancy, is certainly setting a fast pace right now. And Larry King's no small part of that.
Does it frighten you a little? I mean, we push a button and we see someone in Moscow, and they're there and it's clear as a bell. And what's happening next? And satellites and going up 23,000 miles. Most people would think that someone at that cusp of 70 is computer afraid, I think is the term.
That doesn't worry me so much that we will be overnewsed as the fact that, well, let me say it this way. We've got about 3,000 news people here in D.C. who have to justify their existence. And it may be we create some mountainous molehills on our way to capturing attention from one another. It may be that competition, especially in television, is leading us to a less than responsible job of reporting.
You mean so as we increase the technology and be able to do more things, more people want to do more things, so we have irresponsibility?
Generally speaking, news is negative. Noise makes news. People don't want to hear about some rich man who's healthy and happily married. That might tend to make the listener feel sorry for himself. But if that rich man is broke, or if he's diseased, or if he loses his money, or if he's caught with his fingers in the till, that tends to make the reader and the listener feel better. So what's bad news to somebody is really good news to many. There's always somebody in a hospital ward who is worse off to make us feel comparatively fortunate. And that's why the plane crash, which does not involve you, and the beautiful actress with a mastectomy, and the public official in hot water, and the ex-president in exile, and the super-rich car maker caught trafficking in cocaine, that's why these will be on page one. Because the same fire which burns them warms the rest of us. The negative effect, Larry, is that it turns our young people off. They come to think of our country with all of this emphasis on negativism. They come to underestimate their own country, which is the envy of the rest of the world.
David Brinkley wrote a wonderful book called Washington Goes to War, and this program said that nobody ever told anybody that Franklin Roosevelt was in a wheelchair. And when he covered the White House the first time, he said to his colleagues he was just 22. Why don't we tell him that? And he said, not important.
During the Eisenhower administration, when he had ileitis, we started counting his bowel movements on the air, and I thought that was an unnecessary invasion of his privacy, but we've been doing it ever since.
So that's a given. Now, would you agree if we look back, we didn't have to know that Roosevelt was in a wheelchair?
That may be an extreme. No,
but it's amazing that we didn't.
Well, of course, I traveled with him on a couple of trips when it was quite obvious, when Elliot and or James would help him on to
but you didn't go on the air that night and say,
oh no, I didn't go on the air
they
and
they carried him on.
No. And we didn't photograph him being carried on.
Why not?
We photographed him after he was at the lectern. An intrusion on a man's privacy that offered nothing constructive.
Toughest story you ever had to give?
The toughest story I ever had to give?
Well, Cronkite's was the death of Kennedy.
Well, I did a broadcast on the occasion of FDR's death called A Great Tree Has Fallen and Left an Empty Place Against the Sky. And it was told from the perspective of his little dog, Falla. And one radio station, it was then WENR in Chicago, got 25,000 requests for reprints in about a period of about 4 days. I think that was the most agonizing experience of my career.
Because he was, I guess, the only president we knew, huh?
Oh, I didn't think there was ever going to be another president.
Yeah, Godfrey said he had to do his funeral and broke up at the funeral. And it wasn't that he was a young man or taking...
Now, this is not a man with whom I necessarily would have agreed philosophically, but he was still a giant. Oh, my goodness, what a giant. And there are so few. We're up to our ankles in pygmies these days.
Good way to put it. Paul Harvey's our guest. We have just a couple of moments remaining, and I'll figure out how to spend them with this giant after this.
1-800-356-9800.
Our remaining moments with Paul Harvey. What an hour this has been. A couple of other things we didn't cover. people sometimes say Paul Harvey Midwest. They think the king of the Midwest. Is that a, do you like that or not like it?
Oh, I'm honored by it. I used to think that our constituency was largely Western and Midwestern, but when we started the syndicated television series, some of the first stations to get in line were in New England. So I think there's an appetite for political fundamentalism all over the country.
Are your speeches, are you in demand in all areas? I mean, do they want you as much in Florida as they do in Los Angeles, New York? Do you get a lot of requests to come to New York City?
Yes, indeed, and Florida, those that you mentioned especially.
Do you ever talk much to young people? Do you get a chance to go to colleges?
Almost, well, once a week. I'm somewhere on a campus, high school or college level. I've developed that way an enormous respect for much of what our young people stand for, and for some of the things they're refusing to stand for, too. They are a most attentive audience if they find out that you're consistent, if you're right down the line. But, oh, boy, they detect hypocrisy like no other generation heretofore. That's where our politicians run into trouble on college campuses.
Are they learning history, though? Do they know their culture?
According to the numbers, they're not learning as they should, no. History, mathematics, English, that's disappointing. But this, too, will
Someone said they spoke on a campus and mentioned Herbert Hoover, and people didn't know who that was.
If we get embarrassed enough about our educational system, if enough Bill Bennett's step forward and speak out, we'll correct that, too.
I'll see you Saturday night. It'll be my honor.
Thank you, Larry. I'm honored that you're going to be with us for that occasion.
My honor.
Thank you, sir.
I'm going to do a Paul Harvey close. He's going to do me. I'll say thank you for joining us on Larry King Live, and good night.
Yeah, you do that so well, I'm going to feel insecure. Arrivederci.